What's your take on vegetarianism?
Some of our favorite cows are that. And then there's that misguided lion. We've not been able to convince him otherwise.
Well,
and so it's sort of like that. In an effort to offer analogies and such, people could even argue about the analogy of the vortex of creation that we are describing here and turn it into a place and call it a planet. Before you know it, there'll be a planet called Vortex, and they'll be telling people that Abraham said, "You're all going there."
Get happy. Simplistic, we know. That's why we write so many books. But then all of those books, you say, oh, there's so much to learn. Look at all of these pages. There's so much to learn. All of these emotions that I didn't even know that I had. And all of these laws. All of these laws. Look at all of these laws. Universal laws. What in the hell is vibration anyway? I don't understand. Ask and it is given. That's bullshit. I've been asking, where's my stuff? Where's my stuff? I've been asking, where's my stuff? So we give you all of the words and you say, way too many words. And we say, get happy. And you say, oh, too simplistic.
I have two questions. One's really weird and ridiculous, but the other one is really important. So should I ask the important one first?
We prefer the weird one.
Really? Okay. It's kind of embarrassing. Everyone's going to be like, why is she asking that? But anyway.
Is it about talking to dead people?
No.
Oh, then it's not that weird.
Okay. So for the past several years, well, maybe like four, one day I noticed someone spitting. And I really tried hard not to say, oh, I can't stand that because I don't want it to keep happening. Well, anyway, I swear to you, almost every day of my life, I will just sort of like, oh, I'll look over right at the right time and someone has spit. Why didn't I look 2 seconds before? Why didn't I look 2 seconds after? What in the heck? Why do I keep seeing that? I can't believe it.
Because it's active in your vibration.
But I try really hard not to let it be.
But you see, when you try hard not to think about spitting, you're thinking about spitting. So you might want to choose something else that might get your attention.
Okay, well that leads me to my next question.
So choose something less disgusting and work yourself up to rainbows. This conversation, you were amplifying something that made you feel uncomfortable, yes?
Not anymore. It's actually a happy ending story. It was just the beginning.
So you tortured us unnecessarily? You do that to each other, too. Have you ever had a thought about someone that was negative in nature that did not result in their immediate beheading?
My husband's ex-wife.
She survived.
She's still there.
So, if you would accept that you've been sifting through the sands of men for quite a very long time, and that you have created a magnificent relationship of which Fred is a part, but not all-inclusive. In other words, yes. There's stuff that Fred has that's really active and dominant in Fred that is nowhere a vibrational match to what's going on in your vibrational escrow. So meanwhile, the universe knows full well what you want and knows where all of it is and is calling you toward it and giving you evidence that you are focusing well, but all of a sudden, you want to jump in with both feet and with all of your action and go ring Fred's doorbell, and the universe is saying, wrong doorbell, wrong doorbell, wrong doorbell,
okay,
wrong doorbell.
This is the idea on that. I want to go, well, if Fred's not right for me, shouldn't I get to have some experience with Fred and then go, okay, no, thank you, Fred. Why does the universe get to say, Fred's not yours?
Pertaining to my 5-year-old son, he will not listen to me.
Good.
To any... No women. Men, a little better. Teacher told me. She goes, can you get him to listen to me? I say, he won't listen to me. What are you talking about? And
who is he listening to?
I guess his own head, because he told me, he said, you know, I live my life my way and you do things sort of your way. He said, this is way, he said.
He must be listening to us.
Yes.
Want it and don't have it, we still party. We talk about how it was a close call on that one. And how you almost had it. We talk about how you were walking down the street, he was walking down the street, you were in a bad mood and you turned the wrong way. We talk about that. We talk about the veritable fortune that you've amassed and how you deprive yourself of it. And we don't laugh at you, but we think it's funny.
I've created something so wonderful, but that wonderful partner wouldn't want me. That's mm-hmm. what your vibration is saying. Now, talk that down. Or talk yourself into a place where at least your boat can turn.
I'm not the ugliest person in the world. Right?
You're the worst person in the world. No. Actually, that was pretty good.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Is that even, and people say, like, the way that I express what I want, they're like, you'll never find him.
Well, they don't know what they're talking about because he's in vibrational escrow. We've seen him.
Can you give him my number?
You are ready.
I'm ready. So you've seen him.
Yes, and he's not the ugliest person in the world.
He got his master's. I bought him a trip to Hawaii for some relatively spiritual seminar. And I thought, okay, I'll just give it to him and see what happens. He might not even go there. He might just skip the whole thing. But I'm like, oh, I'll give it to him anyway. So he went there. And the seminars were from 7 a.m. to like 6 p.m. So he wouldn't even see any Hawaii. He would be just in the seminar all day long. And he went. And he met this wonderful girl, a Peruvian lady. She's a little older. And they just fell in love. She's from New York. So he's coming home. He's saying, she's moving in with me. So she moves in, they're so in love, they're having sex like crazy. And that was I think that's what made the job came just right away. Now they're living in the house and he just bought his new car and everything is just went into the place in a, like 2 weeks period. And I'm thinking, how can it be? 2 years he couldn't find anything and now all of a sudden everything?
And because alignment trumps everything.
Yeah, and he, yeah.
I am having a ball, and I haven't heard anybody on any of the recordings that I've heard, which hasn't been for very long, talk about humor. And I would like to chew with you about laughter and how laughter is, in my perspective, seems very similar to crying. And is that a shift? I heard you explain crying. I thought it was excellent. Why we cry when we're sad or when we're with joy. It's a jump up the scale where we release resistance.
Well, they are exactly the same in this sense. Now, let's talk about the emotional scale. Love and appreciation and joy, frustration and overwhelmment, mm-hmm. anger, fear, depression.
Right.
And up here in the good feeling emotions is your perception of freedom. Down here in the rotten feeling emotions is your perception of lack of freedom. Now, it's only a perception because you're always free. But right. When you feel not free, that's when the worst feeling emotions are present within you. So the way that crying and laughing are similar is that in both cases, it is a releasing of resistance and a moving right. downstream. So sometimes crying is being in a desperate place, and just crying releases some resistance and moves you in the direction of downstream. Laughing almost always moves you, in other words, when you're really feeling humor, it's always a downstream from where you are.
because you're changing your perspective. And so it's kind of the same process, correct? Because you can cry to the point where you laugh, and you can laugh to the point where you cry. They're almost the same, it's a similar physiological.
Well, let's just start with the idea that in either case, it's a releasing of resistance. So now let's talk about humor. So let's talk about someone trying to cheer you up, and you're not having any of it. And they think they're really, really funny, but they're not funny to you.
I've been on the other side of that, so. But
well, that's really why we're telling you this.
See, now you got me going.
Now that's funny. Because if you're not in the vibrational vicinity, oh, Jerry and Esther have been laughing about this a lot. They have had, and many of you have too, the experience of recognizing that there's this cosmic humor, and we think this is what you're reaching for.
You have it.
But beyond words that Esther's translating, what we're wanting you to realize is, think about this. So the source within you knows who you are, who you really are, and where you are in relationship to who you really are, and is setting up circumstances and events to accommodate you in becoming that which you've asked for. So it's like we've seen the end to all of the movies. Now imagine being in a position where you not only know who you are in your physical form and what you want, but knows everybody else in relationship to it and understands law of attraction and understands that when you get yourself in a particular wavelength, the inevitable unfolding that's going to take place. And much of the humor that you feel when you really feel it exploding within you is because, and you said it earlier, you were right on it, in a sort of sudden one fell swoop, you managed to move bang into alignment with that broader view, and you got the cosmic joke,
the
so
absurdity.
To speak.
You got the absurdity.
You were able to suddenly begin to see it from that broader viewpoint, which made all of that other stuff that was going on, as you said, wisely and accurately and cleverly, irrelevant.
Did I say that? So why did the chicken cross the road?
Now let's talk about humor.
No, seriously.
Wouldn't you? Well, we'll tell you in a minute, or we suspect you'll tell us. But before we go there, let's consider this, and then let's see where we actually go together.
All right.
So the primary basis or tenet, the most important part of humor, is the surprise factor. Mm-hmm. So if you're moving around here and your source is moving around here, and then something happens that gives you the peace that you need to suddenly move here, there is that sort of element of surprise. We think that that's why so many of you like the drama of strong contrast. In other words, think about it. You could know what you don't want a little and know what you do want a little, and then since what you don't want is not a very big deal, it's easy for you to turn to what you do want, and so you achieve vibrational alignment with it, and you get it, and then you know what you don't want, you know what you do want. Since there's not really a big difference in between, it's easy for you to think about what you do want, and you get it. There's not much variation between the vibrations, so it's pretty easy for you to think about what you do want. So under those conditions, it wouldn't be a very big roller coaster ride. It wouldn't be a very dramatic life. It would just be steady, comfortable process. It would be a constant, steady unfolding. But when you really know what you don't want, so you really know what you do want, but you're really nowhere in the vicinity of what you do want, and so now you're working your way up the emotional scale, when this comes into alignment, there's a bigger impact. And frankly, we think you all like the drama of it. We think you like the feeling of, I am the creator of my reality, more than, yeah, I create my reality. You like that sensation of that. And so in this process of humor is that element of surprise. That is the most important factor. Jerry and Esther bought a new car last month, and they have XM radio in it that they have not been listening to before. And there's a comedy channel, and there's a lot of really old, not funny comics on that channel. And Esther's listening to it, and she says, I want to laugh, But there's no element of surprise because it's not leading edge anymore. Right. The concepts aren't leading edge. The ideas aren't leading edge. Most of them she's heard a long, long time ago. They're just not funny to her anymore. That feeling of humor is like that feeling of alignment. And,
right.
and for it to really fly, you got to be out there in that new frontier, experiencing that new territory. That's why you want expansion. That's where the life is. That's where the sensation and zest of life is, you see. We really want to amplify that, that it matters not at all where you put your boat in the stream. You
right.
are where you are, and the stream's moving. And we would okay. say there's as much benefit in the release of crying as there is in the other. In other words, we want you to no longer compare in a sort of standard way that it's so much better to feel these emotions than these emotions. We want you to say, it's good that I feel emotions and that I know what they mean. And I'm
it
always
is.
Reaching for the emotion of relief. That's what you're reaching for. The emotion of relief, because that means I'm moving in the direction of. It's nice when those manifestations begin. To come, but just moving in the direction of them is nice too. And when you really think about it, you're always going to be moving in the direction of things that are to come because you never stop launching more creations. The whole reason for existence is for the joy of life, not for the manifestation of things. You're not on this journey to get it done. There aren't things that have been assigned to you that you need to get done and that you will be disappointed if you don't get done. The whole thing exists for the pleasure of creation while you're within it. And that's why it is humorous to us, and don't take it the wrong way. It is humorous to us that you are killing one another as you argue over whose way of life is the right way when there is not one right way of life. There's just life, and you all get to choose the way. No one else can threaten your way of life. You're worried about the terrorists, and you're worried about bombs, and you're worried about anthrax, and you're worried about things asserting themselves into your experience. And meanwhile, as you stew about all of those things, you give yourself warts on your eyes, and you give yourself diseases. In other words, you are the ones that are destroying your experience by worrying about what everybody else is doing, over which you have no control and have no business having your nose in their business, you see. If you tend to your vibration, you'll not only begin to live this zest-filled life, this humor-filled life, but when you start dancing with the cosmic angels, when you tap in, when you are close enough to vibrational alignment with that energy that creates worlds, the circumstances and events that will be arranged for you will knock your socks off. So the chicken crosses the road because there's always more to see, and he's been over here.
It wants to cross the road.
Doesn't that explain what homesick is? That's where home makes you sick. Haven't you ever gone home and you feel like that same dumb person that they thought you were back then? You haven't felt like that for a long time, and all of a sudden, there it all is, and the smells, and the... We're exaggerating, not at all. We may be channeling Taylor Swift. Haters gotta hate, 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 hate. Haters gotta hate, 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 hate. And you just gotta shake it off. Shake it off.
Thank you.
Because you cannot please them. You can't understand. The only thing that you can do is to come in alignment with your source. And when you do, the return to that steady, consistent love. See, the thing about relatives is that you got to catch them on a good day. You are a vibrational being first and foremost. It's a lovely thing when doctors are forced to acknowledge that. What more would you like us to say?
So when my dad passed away, I helped take care of him the last 9 months of his life. And I was in a cemetery, just biking down and feeling really close to him. And a friend of mine walked away. I said, let me just have a moment. I want to kind of have a moment here. So I was actually talking with him. And at that moment, there was something wet on my leg. I looked down, and there's this little black poodle. And he's just sitting there licking my leg and looking up at me. And I'm petting him and say, "Hi, how are you?" And, you know, it was a nice interaction. And then from across the graveyard, this woman says, "Augie, come here, please. Come here, Augie, leave the man alone." And that was my father's name. It's not like Bozo or Bob or... And I'm like, "Oh, my God." And so I walked over.
Our work here is done. In other words, with what precision can the universe deliver to you demonstrations of... Yeah.
It gets better. So I walk over to this woman, and we had this interaction. I found out that her son had died on the same day as my father. He had committed suicide, and they got this dog for the young boys that were left behind and named him Augie after the month. So we have this moment and blah, blah, blah. 10 years later, which was last week, I'm in a coffee stand sitting there, and another little black poodle comes up and sits at my feet outside. And I'm like, "Oh, my God, hello." And I'm petting him. And I turned to my friend. I said, "Would this be weird if his name is Augie?" And I took his tag and looked at it, and it was my father's nickname he grew up with. They didn't even call him Augie. It was Junior. And this little dog, same little black kind of poodle, is looking at me, and I'm just having this incredible moment. And so I guess my question around this is, do...
Really? You have a question?
So I guess the answer is they come through to let you know something.
Yeah, and your dad would like you to know he doesn't really hang out at the graveyard.
That's good.
So sometimes it feels like you don't really have a hands-on purpose in expanding the universe, because if you're sitting and thinking, "Okay, I am an expander of the universe, what direction should I take it? What important expansion science..." Well, I don't have too much background in that. Genetic, I don't really have too much understanding in that. I'm not a very good comic. Mathematics, no. So it works like this. As we talk about this vortex of creation, must be annoying. It just has to be to someone who is really reality-based. You go home and you say to your friends, "Yeah, I don't know. We learned not to face reality. That's worrisome. And then we were pointed over here at the floor. And we are told that there is a vortex of creation that includes everything we want, but we can't see it. It was a little like smoke and mirrors. And then we were told that if we would feel for it, because we can't see it or hear it or smell it or taste it or touch it, if we would feel for it, we would feel better. And that when we feel better, then it would come. So you've worried, you've fussed, money is slow and seeming to get slower, and now you're beyond worried, you're fearful. And now you're determined that you're going to do something about it. And you've heard that Abraham, that's us, has written brilliant, 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 brilliant affirmation cards. It's true. It's true. This is the best combination of words to attract money that has ever been put together in human experience. We are very proud of these cards. So you're standing outside your vortex, worried and determined to do something about it. So you pick up these brilliant cards and you look for empowerment within them. So you look through them and look through them. "My life is as good as I allow it to be." "I am always receiving the essence of what I am giving." You got to be kidding. I can follow the trails of good feeling thoughts. I can follow the trail of good feeling money, but I don't know about it. The story I tell is the basis of my life. I'm in deep doo-doo. I am the creator of my own life experience. These are not helpful cards. I can see my world through the eyes of Source. I would like to punch out the eyes of Source. I can deliberately choose to feel better now. There's not one good card here. There's not one good card here.
Thank you, Abraham. I so enjoy your daily emails. Puts me in a wonderful place. There's one that comes around about once a year.
There are 800 of them in that, and they come around randomly. Mm-hmm. They're dumped into something and randomly numbered, and then they come up. Mm.
This one, I have some questions about it.
This seminar would put another 800 in.
And it goes, the thinker thinks a thought, and then the thought thinks, becoming a thinker. And then the thought that was a thought that is now a thinker thinks another thought, which becomes a thinker also.
That's just ridiculous, isn't it? We must have been drunk.
Since I was last sitting before you, Esther, and with you, Abraham.
They call us Abrahamster. Or Estherham. Or Abster.
A lot of you are going to relate to this. It's just too funny.
Jerry said to Esther, since you're using my toothpaste today, I would like to point out how neat my tube used to be. It's never had this big grip right in the middle of it before. And Esther said, I know, I'm sorry. But she could not change her toothpaste personality overnight. You just can't go cold turkey on something like that. And so the very next time, because she still had not replaced her toothpaste, she grabbed his toothpaste just like she always grabs his. She grabbed his like she always has grabbed hers and did it again and didn't even realize that she'd done it. Now this time when he found it, now he, at first he could see it as a mindless mistake. But the second time, it looked like deliberate mangling of his toothpaste tube. But it was not. It was mindless managing of a toothpaste tube. It's just the relationship she's had with her tube of toothpaste her entire life. And so Jerry came out into the bus holding his mangled tube of toothpaste and looked deeply into her eyes. And Esther said to him, please tell me that this is not going to be the basis of our relationship. Because I don't think I can change. And they had a good laugh over it. And then, fortunately, Esther has obtained her own tube of toothpaste. And so their relationship was saved. But we want you to realize that as you come together, you are different people and you have different ways of approaching things, and you should not ask even something as simple as that of someone else. In other words, you really have to let people be who they are and accentuate the parts that mesh and desensitize the parts that don't mesh, because there are people who destroy their relationships on things not much bigger than that because the other one seems unwilling to change. And we say, change never happens until the calling. And we weren't calling Esther to the toothpaste in that way, you see.
Thanks for watching. If you liked the video, please give it a thumbs up, and please don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell notification for new upcoming videos.
You're knowing what you are wanting? Are you enjoying the expansion of your personal desires? Are you enjoying the sound of her cell phone? So many of our human friends instead say, I want more money, but I have not enough. In fact, they say, I can't remember ever having enough. I hardly know anyone who has enough. Oh, there's that one guy we all hate. He has enough. He has way more than enough. He has so much, he spends it so frivolously. He spent $100,000 on a closet. Can you believe it? Rich bugger. Government takes most of my money and squander it on things that I would not spend it on. I'm tired of not having enough money. I'm really, 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 really tired of not having enough money. I so want more money. It's not fair that I do not have enough money. Are you kidding me? That blouse is $200 for a blouse? They are so taking advantage of us. And in the moment that you make those statements to yourself, what happens is you stop the activation that's got you pointed that way, and you begin to turn in the stream. And when you turn in the stream, the relief is obvious. Especially if you really, really want something and you're really, really focused against it, in the moment that you stop that, you feel relief. So that's what slumber does for you. When you finally drop off to sleep, you stop that activation, and you know while you slumber, you turn and go with the flow. And then you wake up and you say, oh yeah, I remember my life. As you turn and go back upstream. Whereas law of attraction is not a secret. That's like calling gravity a secret. Like if you don't explain it to somebody, they'll throw something up and it won't come down.
And so you say to us things like, all right, Abraham, I get it. I've heard you enough. Pretty tired of it too. That all the money I want is in the vortex. I just want to get it out of the vortex and into the bank. Into the bank, please. I want my lover in my bed. Not in the vortex. But you can't get crossways of your own preferences. You can't say, I want to love except for that rascal. Every now and again, Esther would find herself crossways of someone. And we convinced her over time that the reason that it felt so awful when she would get crossways of someone is because we were not going there with her. And she said to us on more than one occasion, Abraham, I think you need more information about this person. You might be looking through starry eyes.
My follow-up question has to do with, it's a little bit more esoteric, but the relationship between vibrational...
What could be more esoteric? Then there's this vortex of creation, that, and everything you want is in there. And you have to find some way of creating a vibrational atmosphere so that what's in there can flow over here. So, have we convinced you that being in the vortex is the only game in town?
Yes.
And does it matter at all what subject took you in?
No.
So why would you want to talk about something that you know is hard?
I don't know if it's hard.
But think about it. Oh. Think about it. Well, let's run through that again. Being in the vortex is where you want to be, where you rendezvous with everything that you want.
Yes.
So getting in the vortex is of paramount importance. Some things, and we were just in the vortex together. In other words, you all came in. There we were, in the vortex. And then you did the freakiest, weirdest thing.
Uh-oh.
Instead of milking the vortex we were already in, you thought, well, why don't I go get something that isn't in the vortex and drag it in? And we say, because you don't. You went out, you got hold of it, and now you're out. And it wasn't worth it. So, if I find myself in the vortex, then is it my responsibility to take everything that's ever been an issue and wrestle it to the ground and kill it and drag it into the vortex? Or are all of those out of the vortex things irrelevant? Are they irrelevant? They're irrelevant. The only thing that is relevant is you in relationship to the vortex. So history doesn't matter. Old relationships don't matter. The conversation you had yesterday doesn't matter. Nothing that feels bad is relevant to the vortex. So just leave it out. Is this too simplistic? Is it too hard to wrap your brain around? Are you so oriented to debating it? Have you ever had a difference of opinion with someone and you just talk and talk and talk and talk and talk about it, and neither one of you don't make any headway at all? Republican, Democrat, Republican, Democrat, Republican, on and on and on and on and on and on and on it goes. And meanwhile, your vortex is pregnant. A woman said to us one day, Abraham, my lover left and now I'm sad. And we said, no, you're not. And she said, Abraham, my lover left and now I am sad. And we said, no, you're not. She said, Abraham, I thought you were infinite intelligence. Of course, sleeping in this seminar is evil. Actually, it's a very good place to sleep, isn't it? Vibration of well-being, all is well. We'll wake you up if there's anything important.
You're a group of entities. Are we a group of entities too?
Yes, we are all infinite intelligence.
Ah.
We are just more intelligent. That's why your little ones are happier than you are. They still believe. You haven't convinced them yet that life sucks. You say things to them like, oh, you'll get it in time. Later on, you'll understand. So let's say that you recognize that you're in a place of resistance and you are feeling extra concern because you were on a path of improvement and slipped back from it. And so now you're actually using words like self-sabotage as you're talking about it. And you say, ah, I need to take this bull by the horns and do something about it. I think I will go to an Abraham seminar. I think I will go to an Abraham seminar and I will buy an Abraham product that will really help me to. And so what applies to me? Oh, money applies to me. So you pick up these cards from this place of feeling particularly irritated about sabotaging yourself, and you set out to make things better. You say, I can make a career of living happily ever after. You got to be kidding me. We're each responsible for the thoughts we think. Well, why not just rub salt in my wound? My career is one of creating a joyful life experience. We'll tell that to my debtors. My life is as good as I allow it to be. Well, now that's perfect. That's just perfect. Welcome to planet Earth. You're here to seek joy. Who writes this stuff? So the point that we're making is nothing helps.
It's speaking of getting on with life, so, and bridges.
And with your questions, because they're... We can smell the tar.
I'm making a wonderful transition out of this country into another one. House is rented, all my stuff's gone, and I usually don't focus on the physical, but this transition has, of course, focused me very, very much on the physical. In the process of the last few days, I have a question analogous to where's my stuff, more specifically, where's my passport?
It's hiding in that resistant place with your concern about doing something. Begin calling it temporary. It's a temporary discovery of another place instead of it's a permanent moving to another place, and your passport will reveal itself to you.
It's a temporary...
It's just an indication of your resistance about this. In other words, you said something interesting. You said, I usually don't focus in the physical. Mm-hmm. Well, that's why you can't find your passport. And in other words, you could just show up and say, scan my eyeballs.
Yeah, right.
But they're not ready for that.
I know.
You have to find your passport.
I know.
So, or you could just remind yourself how incredibly easy it is to get a replacement.
Yeah.
And then you'll have two.
Yeah, I know. Exactly. Well, this is also the concept of humor. I'd like a little bit of parsing out. How does source play? Like, humor raises the energy. How do you differentiate the use of humor that elucidates for a group and balance between humor that is towards a group versus what might be hurtful in a sense to an individual? And where do you balance humor versus ridicule versus sarcasm? Versus...
Anything that is spoken from inside the vortex is uplifting in nature. Anything that's spoken from outside the vortex is not uplifting in nature. No one would ever ridicule when they are feeling good about themselves or about something else. So it's really the in the vortex, out of the vortex thing.
So Source never uses humor inappropriately?
Source never does anything inappropriate.
Okay. No, so it's always, it is always
if you take it the wrong way, it's your problem.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
But we are also aware of where you are before we offer anything. And if you can't take it, we don't dish it out. Because our dominant intention at all times is to bring you closer to who you are.
And we're just not quite as good at that sometimes, obviously.
Getting better all the time. Also, the primary gift of humor is the surprise factor.
Yeah.
And the underpinning of the value of the surprise factor is the distraction factor. So often we will use humor to distract from it. That's what Jerry did with Esther. She's thinking about this new garment that she's wanting to wear and sort of struggling with whether she wanted to or not. And the first clear thing that she heard from Jerry was very humorous. Did someone die? Are you kidding me?
Exactly. Well, this brings up the concept of balance. Is what's more important in a sense, balance or the high emotions of love and appreciation? Because balance is something I'm trying to understand more.
Well, the high emotions of love and appreciation are perfect balance.
But they seem to be temporary states a lot of times. They're really high up there. And so it almost seems like a lot of times to be... Because love has... There's obsessive love, and then there is, like, in a sense...
Which is out of the vortex, love.
Right. But we move between these parallels, and so it almost feels like being in between in a balance is its own, you know, bliss, joy, what have you. Like, a balance is its own place outside the polarities.
Well... We disagree with something that you say, because it's true that when you are in love and appreciation, that you are in the ultimate balance, and it's the balance between the source you and the physical you. It's the balance between the inner being you. In other words, when you are out here on the leading edge and you are without resistance and in a complete state of allowance, then the fullness of who you are is there. And that is something that is possible to maintain on a more consistent basis than most anybody does. It requires stronger reason. That's the bridge that Jerry is bringing to Esther. It requires stronger reason you see. So if you have a stronger reason, it's like negative emotion doesn't bother you that much until it gets really strong, and then you do something about it. And so the pickier you are and the more you care about how you feel, the more you will maintain that alignment with who you are. And that alignment with who you are is the, in other words, feel the difference between the emotion that is evoked with the word passion and the idea of the emotion that is evoked with the word love. They feel like different frequencies, in that passion feels more off the wall enthusiastic, right, while love feels more like contentment and satisfaction and that sort of thing. And yet they are the same frequency. And so we just want you to understand that when you're in alignment, your focus might shift. So it might feel like there are highs and lows in it, but it's not highs and lows in the vibration. It's differences in the way the emotions feel.
Vibration versus frequency? Those two
vibration and frequency meaning the same thing.
All right.
Yes.
So
if we were standing in your physical shoes, we would say to ourselves, and on a regular basis until we come to really mean it and know it, that I am happy in a feeling of love. I am happy in a feeling of enthusiasm. I'm happy in a feeling of passion. I'm happy in a feeling of surprise. I just want the majority of my feelings to be coming from inside the vortex, in that delicious mix of possibilities. It would be like trying to define in the painting which color was the most important one.
That's a nice metaphor.
When it's a tapestry that's all blended together and each part of it makes the other richer. And you're right. There is, in essence, a sort of contrast in emotion, but there's not a vibrational contrast in those emotions of alignment. First time we've said that. That's really an important thing to acknowledge. There's not a vibrational difference between love and appreciation, and yet they are different. They are different parts of the tapestry. They are all that high, pure frequency, you see.
All right, well,
but there's a big vibrational difference between love and hate, or love and worry, or love and fear, or love and loss.
Yet we will be creating more vibrational difference as we move forward. In other words,
more subtle difference. More subtle difference, you see. But here's a really wonderful thing to acknowledge. Non-physical has variance in vibration, but it is so insignificant that humans couldn't feel the difference.
Sure.
Wouldn't it be really a wonderful thing to be physically focused and learn to project yourself, focus yourself so specifically that the personal causation that you are accomplishing is all what you would call positive emotion. And let's not nitpick over which is better, love or appreciation or a feeling of satisfaction and contentment. Esther was trying to describe it the other night as she was sitting with Tracy and with one of her sisters, visiting and appreciating the perfection of how all of this played out relative to Jerry's transition, how everything's in place. The list just goes on, and her feeling of appreciation was just intense and focused, and a feeling of well-being, unlike anything that she's felt before. So it was uniquely the addition that Jerry was contributing to it, washed over her, not over her, through her, in and out of her, everywhere. And she was trying to describe, they could tell by the expression on her face that something wonderful was going on, but she was trying to describe it. And she said, it's like every positive emotion that I've ever felt or tried to define is present within me in a feeling way to which there are not adequate words, you see. And that's that kind of bridging that we're talking about. You've always all had access to all of that because we've always been there for all of you. But for differing reasons and to different degrees, you hold us apart, you see.
Go ahead, please.
Go ahead, please.
On this concept of the tapestry, how did Source get created, and what was the creational path of Source?
Well, it's an evolution that's been going on for so long that trying to find the beginning place of that could not be more counterproductive. It really would be like saying, I am a master chef, and I have a palate that is so sophisticated, I eat what I like, and I like what I eat, but hardly anybody else gets it like I do. It's really, 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 really sophisticatedly divine. But I'm going to spend the next week or month or so figuring out what the first man cooked on the fire. Where'd he get it? What kind of utensils did he use to cook it? And we say, you're not going to like it when you go there. So
just go for
it. It was
here.
Overcooked the first time. It was a big old tough piece of dinosaur that no one would want to eat.
Right. So just go from here.
Yes, man was here with the dinosaur.
Nice.
And.
Nice.
You get the sense of what. And
so give a number. Can we have a number? What the heck? Isn't there a number? Come on, just for the heck of it. Fun? No? All right, forget it. Fine. All right,
you're
in our context. We like to know things. We do like to know.
Get out.
All right.
If you will, we'll let him sit down and then we'll break it to him. They all know something that you don't know, and that is that it is the end of this segment. You don't have to sit here during segment of refreshment, but we will begin with you when we return.
Okay.
Good time for it.